JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFT's daily market review for August the 5th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, head of research here at JFT, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher against all but one of the other major currencies on Wednesday and during the Asian session Thursday. It gained the most versus JPY and CHF, while it eked out the least gains versus Aussie and Kiwi. The greenback was found virtually unchanged against the Canadian dollar. Now, although the strengthening of the US dollar points to risk aversion, the weakening of the yen and franc, combined with the relative strength of the risk-linked Aussie, Kiwi and Loonie, suggests that investors may have traded otherwise. So looking at the performance of major global stock indices, we see that major European ones recorded gains, but investor morale deteriorated during the US session and rolled over soft into the Asian session today. Now, European shares hit fresh highs yesterday with optimism over second quarter earnings keep adding fuel to the latest rally. However, looking at the details, we see that the main driver yesterday was technology stocks, which hit a 20-year peak. History has shown that technology is fairly resilient to any economic disruptions caused by the pandemic, and thus being the best performer in the midst of rising cases of the Delta variant suggests that the virus-related concerns have not vanished yet. In the US, both the Dow and the S&P finished in the red, with only the tech-heavy Nasdaq rising somewhat. Market chatter suggests that this may have been the result of the ADP report revealing that the private sector has gained less than projected jobs. Actually, it added less than half of what analysts have forecasted. In any case, we don't believe that this could have been the reason for the slide in Wall Street. After all, weaker jobs growth could mean a later tapering by the Fed, as well as later rate increases. And as we noted several times in the recent past, low borrowing costs for longer is something good for equities. In our view, the driver were hawkish remarks by Fed Vice Chair Richard Clarida, who said that the conditions for raising interest rates could be met by the end of 2022. Remember that the dot plot has suggested that the first rate increase could come in 2023, and the Fed fund futures have been pointing for such an action to come in the first 3 or 4 months of 2023. So Clarida appeared more hawkish than the consensus. Dallas Fed President Robert Kaplan and St. Louis Fed President James Bullard also sounded relatively hawkish, advocating for reducing the monthly asset purchases very soon. Now, later in the day, today, the main event on the agenda may be the Bank of England monetary policy decision. This is a Super Thursday, where apart from the decision, the meeting statement and the minutes, we also get updated economic projections and a press conference by Governor Andrew Bailey. Last time, this bank decided to keep its policy settings unchanged, with only one member voting in favor of quantitative easing tapering. That member was Chief Economist Andy Haldane, for whom that was the last meeting. The bank repeated that the surge in inflation is expected to be transitory and added that they do not want to undermine the recovery by premature tightening, disappointing those expecting signals that something like that could be announced soon. However, since then, a couple of officials expressed the view that tapering should start sooner than previously thought. Thus, it would be interesting to see whether we will have, and if so, how many votes in favor of tapering. We will also dig into the statement and the minutes for clues as to whether even those voting against quantitative easing tapering are planning to support such an action at the upcoming gatherings. Now, with regards to the economic projections, officials could raise their inflation forecasts, but still hold the view that the surge is likely to prove to be transitory. That said, due to concerns over the Delta variant of the coronavirus, the growth outlook remains uncertain. In any case, a more hawkish vibe than previously could support the British pound. Now, as for the rest of today's events, besides the Bank of England decision, today's agenda also includes the US initial jobless claims for last week, which are expected to have declined to 384K from 400K, as well as Canada's trade balance for June, with the nation's deficit expected to have narrowed by nearly 0.6 billion loonies. As for the speakers, we will get to hear from Fed Board Governor Christopher Waller. However, we don't expect him to say something we don't already know. He spoke a couple of days ago and said that he and his colleagues should go early and go fast on quantitative easing tapering. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.